Today, I want to look a little more closely at the schism between analytic and continental schools, and we will focus, not entirely, but mostly upon the continental tradition as it continues the rejection of a correspondence view of reality, which we began to consider in the last lesson. To understand the split, we really have to recall the one before it, between rationalism and empiricism. Now, if the claims of the growing empiricist camp are correct, then a few things follow. First of all, if the material world is all there is, then that I of which Descartes spoke, from a staunch empiricist perspective, the significance of individual experience is downplayed, and with it, all kinds of things. For example, individual human rights. The empiricist Jeremy Bentham during this time said that that kind of talk just amounts to nonsense on stilts, because nowhere in our empirical experience will we find these things that we call human rights. A second problem involves the fact that everything in a material world seems to be regulated by laws. It's mechanistic, so there's not really any room for free will and free choice. So the I is a doubtful thing, and the free will assertions of the I, whatever that is also doubtful. So individual experience becomes insignificant, and free will becomes doubtful. Well, Romanticism in general was a movement in the 1800s that was pushing back in reaction to many of these claims of the Enlightenment heritage. So within the Enlightenment heritage, we have the tension between rationalism and empiricism. Now we've got a tension between the Enlightenment heritage of the 1700s and the Romantic heritage of the 1800s. Romanticism stressed individuality, subjective experience, even supernatural and spiritual experiences. During this time, some of Berkeley's ideas received new life, though whereas Berkeley was tongue-in-cheek, now they're being asserted matter-of-factly. So that third school of idealism is still questioning whether anything exists outside of the mind. George Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel suggested that all things, including the material world, including you and I, are just ideas within an all-encompassing, ultimate, supreme mind. In this case, subjective experience really is the end of all things, and so it's more important at the end of the day than empirical, quote, knowing. Now, a lot of this goes back to Kant. Kant solved one problem, but he raised another. His Copernican revolution was the suggestion that instead of thinking that the mind is informed according to the way the world is, we construct our understanding of the world according to what is already in the mind. So there are certain things about our empirical experience that we cannot rationally prove, yet given the fact of our collective convictions relating to our rational intuitions, we can have confidence and live as if we could prove it. That as if is an important clause. So the Romantics, emphasizing the superiority of individual subjective experiences over empirical claims to fact, took this and ran with it. Romantics embraced the irrational as meaningful. There are higher concepts of which we are certain, yet the empiricists say that we cannot prove these things. So, we will have to take a leap of faith to live as if we could demonstrate in logical and empirical proof what we know is real anyway. Romantics were all about the ideal of beauty, the experience of being enraptured by beauty in nature and the arts. And so we can't really speak in a comprehensive sense about beauty. And this makes sense because beauty, if it is something more than our experience, transcends the experience. That's what makes it so meaningful. And so it cannot be wholly grasped within the experience, and it cannot be wholly grasped with our limited vocabulary. So we live and speak about beauty as if it were fully known to us and understood, because our pragmatic experience, though imperfect, testifies to its existence and meaningfulness. If the most meaningful aspects of our lives are these ideals of which we are certain, yet concerning which the empiricists remind us that we cannot rationally prove, then we must take a leap of faith in these supposedly irrational ideals and live as if we could prove that what we know is true were rationally demonstrable. So we began with the tension within the Enlightenment tradition. Kant offered a solution to that problem, but now we have a new tension between two traditions, the continuing Enlightenment tradition and the new Romantic tradition. In reaction to Romanticism, by the time we get to the 1900s, the analytic tradition was asserting more forcefully a rigid rationalism and empiricism. This was called positivism and logical positivism. Truth and meaning can only refer to that which can be proven through scientific verification and logical proof. Something else that had begun with the Enlightenment push towards empiricism and continued even on into the Romantic tradition, which really culminated in Nietzsche's famous assertion, "God is dead," was a growing rejection of Western tradition's emphasis on higher truths, such as religious truths. Coinciding with this growing mistrust of Western tradition was modernism's emphasis upon scientific absolutes as the new highest truth. This is when science was crowned king of epistemology. Of course, along with much technological progress and conveniences, the world witnessed much destruction. Modernism championed a great optimism concerning humanity with science as our guiding light into the future. But now, that view was being challenged. In many ways, postmodernism was a return to the Romantic ideals, emphasizing individual truth and subjective perspective, and even spiritualized experiences. Interestingly, however, although postmodernism was a reaction and challenge to the modernist tradition and modernity in general, postmodernism embraced and continued many of the presumptions of modernism. For example, the materialist presumption and the pushing away from Western appeals to higher truths. Yet without science as the new authority, we're really left with no authority except for subjectivity or communal experiences. Now, to be clear, this is an oversimplification. These are generalizations. You will find, for example, theists within either camp. I am mainly speaking to the mainstream ideologies that have historically represented the schools of thought or the shifts in perspective. So, generally speaking, the analytic school tended to continue the Enlightenment tradition, focusing on rationalism and empiricism, and these were philosophers of science and philosophers of logic and language. This included in the 1930s the logical positivists. On this view, that which can be proved logically or scientifically is the only thing that can be said to count as meaningful. Within this tradition, A.J. Ayer famously said, "If you can't prove what wrongness means when you say murder is wrong, then all you've really said is murder, boo, or I don't like murder." And some philosophers within this analytic tradition began to focus on the extent to which our claims on knowledge really just amount to language games relating to our experience. Now, the analytic school does include philosophers who have revisited or sought to integrate traditional or classical perspectives. But generally speaking, the weight or validity of epistemic claims in this tradition is measured by or rests upon rational proofs or empirical evidences. The Continental School originated from mostly French and German-influenced schools of thought, which stressed subjectivity and experience rather than empirical or logical proof. Again, there was a large Kantian influence. Remember, Kant had distinguished the phenomena of physical experience from the noumena, the things in themselves, perceived by the mind, yet which cannot ever really be known. This means that all knowledge and experience are shaped by things upon which we can reflect and ponder, but nothing can be really empirically and logically explored. There were many schools of thought growing out of this tradition. Some of the more popular ones included Marxism, phenomenology, and existentialism. So I want to be careful here not to create an us-them either-or dichotomy, but to note the strength of each tradition as an approach to methodology, and then to frame a particular point of tension as it relates to assertions concerning epistemology, because that point of tension will show up quite a bit today. So first, analytic and continental can refer to the specific circles of thought within the traditions, like logical positivism, the ordinary language movement, pragmatism, existentialism, critical theory, post-structuralism, etc. Analytic or continental might also refer to certain presuppositions within those schools of thought, or these terms could also refer to the basic methodology of the tradition as a whole or certain schools of thought within the tradition. An analytic approach or a continental approach. And this distinction is important for the sake of charity because I can disagree with some perspective's conclusion while also seeing value in its approach to the dialogue. So the analytic approach, that is the analytic methodology, in general, is to scrutinize language or logic or stress empirical investigation, which might include observation, experimentation, etc., or even to theorize about what logical or empirical parameters would best explain something like consciousness, for example. That's philosophy of mind. Or what logical parameters do we need to consider when theorizing about possible worlds? That shows up in philosophy of religion, when you consider some possible worlds and all possible worlds. This seems too abstract and removed to the continental perspective. Yet it is important, for example, when it comes to questions of justice, to analyze the foundations in which justice can even be grounded. If you cannot ground an appeal to justice, it does not really matter how nice your appeal or ideal of justice may seem, the reasoning will not carry much force beyond any emotional appeal. And emotional appeals will only go so far. Yet, the continental perspective is also valuable in that the analytic approach can get lost in the abstract and never drive one toward action and application. In this case, it might be just as easily challenged that the arguments themselves also lack force to enact change. In this case, philosophy seems more to some like mathematics. It's all nice and interesting to study in the classroom, but what does it really mean for the student until it is applied to their lives? This is the continental concern. The approach of the continental tradition has been to emphasize, one, the significance of the subject, lived experience, embodied experience, as we struggle with anxiety in the face of a seemingly absurd world or seemingly absurd circumstances, and the quest for meaning and significance, individual identity. Two, significant historical developments in culture and society and economics. The philosophy of history, not to be confused with history of philosophy, really grew out of this tradition. Three, ideological power struggles relating to socio-political structures and ideologies ingrained within cultures through institutionalized norms and systems. Here you can really see the term critical methodology showing up. The critical has to do with critical thinking and critiquing. So when you employ a critical methodology, you are critiquing what is considered the common knowledge or the foundational presumptions which inform certain norms, practices, traditions, or expectations within society. And fourth, relating to this critical tradition within continental thought, you will also encounter several schools of thought that emphasize social justice. Although justice and injustice may at times be defined in particular ways with which some may take issue, regardless of whether they approach philosophy from a perspective of analytic methodology or continental methodology. Now, one thing to understand as it relates to this emphasis on social justice is that the continental school has almost always had a concern for the individual who is alienated by sociopolitical structures. This is why Karl Marx was so concerned with the working class being alienated by the nature of the owning class, which he considered to be the evils of capitalism. So too, the social justice movement, the critical theory movement, is concerned for the individual whose values, morals, lifestyle, perspective, etc. are marginalized, or as they call it, oppressed, by mainstream ideologies. There's a lot there to unpack, both good and problematic ideas, and we're not going there now. But I do want us to understand the tensions and disagreement between the analytic and continental perspectives, and I think we can do this effectively using abortion as an analogy. Defenders of pro-life stress the analytical point that it is wrong to kill any human being. Human babies are human beings, thus it is wrong to kill human babies, for the reasons typically given in favor of abortion on demand. Now, this is sound reasoning, but it doesn't directly mean much to the advocate of abortion whose best friend or sister has conceived a child after being raped. The concern of the former, from the analytic perspective, is on what is right and what is wrong. And this is a terribly important point. But the concern of the latter is on tragedy and the significance of the individual dealing with the absurdity of the situation. This is why I think continental thought has become so prominent even in pop culture. The simplified ideas are more accessible and more applicable to the individual struggling for identity within culture, while the analytic approach to philosophy has continued to seem, for many people, boring and irrelevant esoteric puzzles that stuffy old professors like to sit around and talk about, but stuff that doesn't really impact my life. Now, my point is this. There are problems within both traditions. Ideologies that have either embraced or implied relativism, for example, which undermines any substantive appeal to a robust sense of justice. These have shown up within both traditions. So it's important to remember that one can disagree with an ideology or a particular school of thought within a tradition, or even some particular claims within a school of thought within a tradition, while still appreciating or even making use of the methodology associated with the tradition or the ideology. This week we will encounter some claims, at least one, that will divide us. And this claim grows out of a particular school of thought within the continental tradition. Yet, wherever we find ourselves, as it relates to this particular continental ideology, whether we find it personally meaningful or analytically problematic, we can still recognize, understand, and appreciate that both sides of this divide in feminist epistemology have approached philosophy from a continental methodology in general, and a critical methodology in particular. So too, with some of critical theory's claims on social justice, we may find them personally significant and therefore compelling, or we may find them logically fallacious, yet we can still value the critical approach to methodology, its concern with human experience, asking whether all perspectives are being represented, and its attempt in some ways to imitate Socrates in digging at what we really know when we claim to have knowledge, and whether we might ever use ignorance in abusive ways. Yet we should also keep the analytic critic in mind. Continental thought loves to stress the us and the other, and often expresses discomfort with binaries of any kind. While the analytic philosopher can identify with the concern for the us and the other divide, they might draw a distinction between social binaries and, for example, moral binaries or truth binaries, because truth is always asserted as a binary. When you say something is true, that implies that the opposite is false. Additionally, save some brief overlap with the continental tradition and pragmatic schools of thought, the continental tradition is more comfortable with the idea of truth and knowledge as a whole as historically evolving. So we don't ever really have knowledge, it's always evolving, and it's all a big dialectic. Therefore, we just need more and more perspectives to get a better idea and expand our knowledge, but we don't ever really have truth. This is problematic, with good reason, for many within the analytic tradition. Let's end with two stories that really draw out the tension between classicism, or the Enlightenment project, and romanticism. Recall that the former is highly rationalist and empiricist, while the latter, stressing individual experience, is more open to meaning and the irrational, and things that cannot always be directly experienced by the senses.
I'd like to begin by asking you if you know why you're here.
Of course. You think I'm crazy?
He claims to be not human. A visitor from another planet.
K-Pax.
K-Pax?
That's about 1,000 of your light years away.
Really? Well, let's hope extraterrestrials qualify for Medicaid.
You're really from up there?
He certainly has a way about him.
That's a lovely configuration you're wearing today.
Everyone wants to know about the alien patient.
He most definitely has a sensitivity to white light. He can detect a wavelength of up to 400 angstroms. Ultraviolet.
I didn't think human beings could see ultraviolet light.
We can't.
Your produce alone has been worth the trip.
I would like to go there, to your planet.
I'm afraid I can only take one person back with me when I go.
I'm the one going.
You're beaming back to K-Pax.
On July 27th.
Why July 27th?
I'm going to have a great time explaining that I got psychotics on the fourth floor packing up their sneakers because they all think they're going off to K-Pax.
He's the most convincing delusional I've ever come across.
I will miss you, Dr. Powell.
What are you afraid of? What is this patient doing to you?
He's telling me that on July 27th, something terrible happened to him. I've got to get to him before that date. Time is running out for him.
You know what I've learned about your planet? There's enough life on Earth to fill 50 planets. Be prepared for anything. She says she doesn't hear so well on her left side, so don't sneak up on her anymore.
No way.
What would you say if I were to tell you I believe you're as human as I am?
I would say you're in need of a Thorazine drip, Doctor. I'm K-Pax. When I'm gone, nobody misses me. There would be no reason to. Yet I sense that when I leave here...
What the hell?
I will be missed. Strange feeling. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have a beam of light to catch. Dein Gesicht.
Meine Töchter führen die nächtlichen Reihen und wiegen und tanzen und singen dich ein. Sie wiegen und tanzen und singen dich ein. Mein Vater, und siehst du nicht dort, der Königstöchter am düsteren Ort? Mein Sohn, ich seh es genau, es scheinen die alten Weiden so grau. Ich liebe dich, mich reizt deine schöne Gestalt, und bist du nicht willig, so brauch ich Gewalt. Mein Vater, jetzt fasst er mich an. Der König hat mir ein Leid getan. Dem Vater grauset's, ihr reitet geschwind, ihr hält in Armen das ächzende Kind. Er reicht den Hof mit Höh und Not. Seinen Armen das Kind war tot.
The Romantics loved leaving stories with the open question. Note that in neither of these stories do we really know what happened. Spoiler alert, in K-Pax at the end, on the day when he was said to catch a beam of light and go back home to his planet, if the alien essence did not entail the physical human body, but rather had to take on that form in order to dwell among us while visiting, what would be the disconfirmation? If you find a dead body on the day he said he was catching his ride back home, what would that prove? His claim was he was going home, and that the body was only a vessel while visiting. Are the other odd things that happen throughout the film enough to serve as cumulative case evidences that this guy might be who he says he is? Or, since it cannot be verified empirically and certainly not rationalized, is it not true? Well, at the end, you don't really know, but it leaves you wondering. Similarly, with the Erkenich, the Earl King, we don't really know what happened. The boy had a fever, he was sick, and maybe already dying in the father's arms as the father is racing home to try to care for him. They travel through the woods. The boy is certain that he sees the Earl King. Now, the Earl King was said to come lure children to his realm. Now, to leave this realm, one has to leave behind the body, shed the body, because it's the spirit that goes to the Earl King's realm. So the Earl King lured children into death. Now the boy is certain he sees these things. The father sees nothing. It's just the wind. At one point, the boy cries out that the Earl King has him. By the time the father reaches the destination, the boy is dead in his arms. Now, is there such thing as the Earl King, and the Earl King in fact took him, leaving the lifeless child in the father's arms? Or was the boy so sick with such a high fever that he was hallucinating these things? We don't have the epistemic access. All we're left with are speculations. But if we have to make a choice, which answer is more likely and why? Do we choose the rationalist empiricist option, Or ought we to embrace the possibility of the irrational?